Hello. So, oh, there's hair on my mic. I got a microphone. Let's see if you can see it. I got a microphone. I am a legitimate ASMRist now. So, I figured sorry about any heavy breathing noises. I am completely new to this. Like, I unboxed it today and was just playing with it and whispering in it. I'm actually gonna do a mic test video, but I figured before we can do that, I wanted to start a new video series for my channel. We are going to start a true crime series on my channel, and I am so excited because I love true crime. I love serial killers. That sounds bad, but it's true. I just love it. And so what I'm gonna try to do is I'm going to try to and go over our serial killer this week. And this week's serial killer is my favorite, my absolute favorite, H.H. Holmes. He is considered America's first serial killer. And so I've got some, let's not try to make this too loud, and I'm sorry if it is. I've got some notes here. I've got quite a few notes, so let's get started. Oh, by the way, it's me, Kat. How are y'all? How have you been? How was your Christmas? How is your New Year's going, or was it? I have to work tomorrow, so I'm not really getting to spend series. He was said to be very intelligent at a very young age. In fact, he showed an interest in medicine, and that led him to enroll at the University of Michigan, their medical program. And so back in the day, basically, they didn't do a lot of, it was like really wildly inappropriate to like dissect people, to learn about the human body, to do anything like that. So he really found a way to do that legally, well, legally, by enrolling in medical school. And I mean, this is the 1800s that we're talking about here, so, you know, there was still that he would be in were not very hands-on, so it would be like, have y'all ever seen Bram Stoker's Dracula with Gary Oldman and Keanu Reeves? That scene where they're all like in that big stadium, and then they were in that big stadium, and then there's like the person at the bottom like dissecting that rabbit or whatever it was. It was like that. So he got really bored with that. He didn't really like it. So insurance scams. And so what they would do is he would like have these people take out insurance, life insurance, like just any kind of insurance, and put it in his name, and then that he would go and be like, oh, my friend died, here's the burnt body. And it was obviously not their friend or his friend, and then they would claim the life insurance. Well, they ended up running a scam on him, and they got a little bit of money on it, but of course, like, source you go to. And he took control of the farm. scared about the whole thing, and he was constantly up firing people. And so let's see, what is it saying? There was one there was this one company that he came, and they were like, you're not paying your bill, so we need to take your stuff. And he hid it in his hotel, and they couldn't find it, and so they just quit. They just quit looking. Like, okay, so he had this vault. I don't want to jump ahead, but he had this vault on the third floor, like a giant bank vault on the third floor attached to his apartment. And he had it built into the building, and so he didn't pay the company that built the vault, right? And so they came to repossess it, and they were like, you haven't paid for this, so we're going to take it back. And he was like, oh yeah, go ahead, that's fine. But if you damage my building, I will sue you. And so the company was like, saw that it was built in the building, like calculated how much it would cost to win, if they would even win the lawsuit, and they just gave it to him. They were like, all right, bro, you can just have it. Like, it's not worth it. Like, that's how he swindled people all the time. All the time he was swindling people. And so, okay, let's get into the construction. The design was 3 stories plus a basement. The first story was a storefront with the pharmacy that we already know about. The second floor was the torture rooms with chutes, like giant like laundry chutes that ran directly to the basement. And then his third was more apartment rooms. So it was like the first floor was the store and everything where he had like a lot of people work. The second was the torture room, and the third was like more apartments, and that's where he lived too. So you basically, if he assigned you a room to the second floor, you're dead. Like, you're not coming back. Sorry, bro. R.I.P. You're gone. But he did have like a lot of people stay there all the time, just, you know, to keep up appearances. So let's go into the torture rooms. So there was a bunch of, like I said, a lot of people built this hotel, a lot of people, and they didn't really question the layout of anything, which I think is insane. Like, how are you not? Okay, just wait. So he had airtight rooms, like some of them were as big as this closet. He had like tiny little rooms in some of these hallways. He had hallways that went nowhere. He had doorways that you'd open up and it was like a blank wall. He had airtight rooms with gas pipes leading to a control, like a control thing that was located in his apartment that he could like turn the gas on because he had gas pipes, and asphyxiate. There's my lisp coming back. He would asphyxiate these people in their room just at will, and no one really questioned why he had these pipes just leading to an open room. No one was like, yo bro, this is a little weird. I think one person did actually, and they were like, why do you only have control of it? And he was like, oh, you know how cold it gets sometimes. And the dude just dropped in. And so he had airtight rooms with the gas pipes. He had rooms with hinged walls so they'd like flip around, and he had false partitions in a lot of the rooms. And then he had rooms that were linked with secret passages so he could like go in and out and just kill you at will. He had rooms that locked from the outside, so he would like give these people a key, or like to show these people to the room and then lock them in. And then those were usually the rooms with the airtight rooms and the gas pipes, you know. He had hallways that led to nowhere, like I said. He had rooms no bigger than broom closets. And then he had these chutes, these like greased chutes, that led straight to the basement, where he had outfitted acid vats, quicklime pits, and he had his own crematorium. And funny thing, not funny but funny, whenever they put in the furnace, he asked the construction worker, he was like, hey, burn hot enough to burn away smell. Like, burn away any smell. Because, you know, glass blowing totally gives off a smell. And the dude was like, well, you know, that's kind of a funny question. But, yeah, I think it could burn away any smell. Like, and after the fact, the dude was like, yeah, you know, I should have really been tipped off by that question. But he really wasn't. And so, like, this is just how insane it was back then. Like, you had all of these people coming in. Okay, I'm getting ahead of myself. So, he said, if it was hot enough to burn away smells, and the dude was like, yeah, I think so. Like, I don't see why it wouldn't be. So, the basement also had surgical tables and tools to dissect and experiment on the corpses that he would get from the chutes, right? It was also said that he ran an abortion clinic out of the basement. And I say that very lightly because I couldn't really find anything, but last podcast on the left mentioned it, and they mentioned how a lot of the people that would come to him for abortions wouldn't make it out. Yeah, they would just disappear. And so, they had surgical tables and tools to dissect and experiment on the bodies, so much so that he had this guy, Benjamin Peitzel, which we'll come back to. Basically, this guy, he would, like, give him some of the bodies to put the skeletons together, because they would go and sell the skeletons and sometimes, like, the organs and stuff to, like, the black market or to medical and, like, medical offices and medical schools for profit. Like, so what does it say? Yeah, sometimes selling the skeletons of his victims to medical offices and schools for profit, and they'd get, like, $200 a corpse. But, like, these people never questioned where he's getting these bodies from. And of course, like, he didn't do it too often to be suspicious, but he did it enough. And then the other victims would be disposed of using the lime pits or acid. And this is why they don't really know how many people he killed. And like I said, it's between 20 to 200. Because he only confessed to 27 plus 6 attempted. But researchers think it's closer to 200. Which is crazy. Super crazy. Can you imagine killing 200 people? Next page. So, like I said, the World's Fair was being held in Chicago that year. And what he would do, so the World's Fair brought in a lot of people. It brought in so many people coming through Chicago. And they needed a place to stay. And so a lot of them would stay at his hotel. Not a lot, but there was a lot of people who stayed at his hotel to visit the World's Fair. And some of them never came back. They would just check in and never check out. And so no one really thought it was weird. Like, if your family member went missing, because you have to think this is in the 1800s. They didn't have cell phones. They didn't have telephones. Like, you wrote a letter. And the letter basically, like, and that's what he would do too. Like, he would make his victims, like, write letters, some of them, to their family and be like, hey, I'm okay. I found a job. It's all good. Like, if you don't hear from me, like, it's okay. I'm fine. And that's how he got away with it a lot of the times. But anyways, a lot of the victims were women, like I said, and he would seduce them. And many times he would get engaged to them just so that he could obtain their life's assets, like their money and their land, if they had any. There was this one case, let me not get ahead of myself. A lot of the people, like a lot of his workers, would disappear too. Like, the people that worked on the first floor, they would disappear, and the cops wouldn't really question it, even though literally all of their belongings would be in their room. Like, they would, it's like they literally just up and left, and he would be like, oh, well, I don't really know what happened. They just left. Like, was like dapper as hell. And so he was very charming, and he just charmed these women into doing whatever he wanted, whatever he said. And so these women who come from like country towns with like not even 100 people see this guy flirting with them, and they're like, oh yeah, I'm gonna do whatever this guy says. And that ended up getting them killed most of the time. But anyways, on the third floor, he also had a vault, like a big bang vault. The same one that they tried to, take away. And I can't remember, I couldn't think of the word. Repossess, that's what it is. He had a giant bang vault on the third floor, and it was airtight. Used this to asphyxiate a lot of people. Like, a lot of people. There was these two sisters that came out, and I think their names were Minnie and Winnie. I know one of them was definitely Minnie, like Minnie Mouse. And he was trying to marry her, and so they came out to the World's Fair, and he like showed him around, showed him a good time, but he got tired. Sisters to go into the vault, and he like closed the door behind her, and she died. She asphyxiated, and he listened to her die, because it wasn't soundproof. She was like banging on the door, and that's why I don't understand like how he convinced the other sister to go in there. Like, wouldn't she have heard it? But he convinced the other sister, and she died too. Both of these sisters died. But somehow he convinced them to transfer all of their money and land, because they had quite a bit of land in Texas, actually, to him. And so I think he actually ends up going there at some point. So both of these sisters died in this vault that he had, and he did that to a lot of women and a lot of people. He just like asphyxiated them. Jesus, Caitlin, get a hold of yourself. And he would listen to them and get off, obviously, because this dude was a freaking psycho. So he, let's start talking about his capture, because we're about 30 minutes in. Wanted to commit one more insurance fraud with his guy, Benjamin Peitzel. And Peitzel was supposed to fake his death to collect a $10,000 life insurance policy that Peitzel would use to help his wife, and he had five children, have a better life. And his wife was in on the plan. She was like, okay, cool, like I can do this, that's totally great. Something happened, and Peitzel was like supposed to do something. I can't remember exactly what. And he didn't do it in time, and so it kind of screwed up the plan a little bit. So Peitzel killed him. Holmes killed Peitzel. And he claimed life insurance money. Well, he told Peitzel's wife that Peitzel was hiding, and he would like, he said, okay, your husband's in hiding, I'm gonna take you to him, but I need you to give me three of your kids, and I'll take them to him, and then I'll take you as well, like, I'll take you after that. And so she agreed. She gave him like her three oldest kids. She had five kids, two little babies, and then five older kids. And I think the three older kids were like 7, 5, and 11 or something like that. And so, let's see. So what he would do is he would take the kids first and like try was traveling with all these kids, like, he kept it all separate. So, like, there was one point, I think, in Georgia where all of the three people, like, all the three groups were a block away from each other. So, like, Mrs. Peitzel was here, the kids were here, and then his wife was here, which is completely insane. So they would all travel, like, not together, but simultaneously in the same spots. And so he would tell Mrs. Peitzel, like, oh, your husband's in Texas. And they'd go to Texas. And then he'd be like, oh, no, he had to go to some other place. He had to go some other place. Like, just kept moving them. And he had the kids with him, too. He then went and, like, got his knife sharpened, and he cut this confession, I believe, because he was in jail and he was like writing out his confession. And it says, I was born with the devil in me. I could not help the fact that I was a murderer, no more than a poet can help the inspiration to sing. His neck did not snap whenever they sprung the trap. He twitched and strangled for over 15 minutes. 15 minutes before being pronounced dead 20 minutes after the trap sprung. So he like twitched there for 15 minutes. 5 minutes later, they were like, oh yeah, you're dead. Which is crazy. And he freaking deserved it because he killed so many people. Sixty.